Thank you for coming to our first ever lecture on a Saturday. We are very thrilled. We've had some other events on Saturdays, but this has been our first lecture. We extend a warm welcome to those of you who are visiting us for the first time. We're very excited to have a guest, our latest guest from the U.S. Speaker's Office here at the embassy, Anthony Marra, who has had quite a productive program here. Originally from Washington, D.C., Anthony is a graduate with a BA from the University of Southern California, an MFA from the Iowa Writers Workshop at the University of Iowa, considered to be one of the best such of these programs in the United States. He is author of A Constellation of Vital Phenomena, which was published in 2013. This is a beautifully written story that starts with a Russian doctor attempting to save a Chechen child who has suddenly become orphaned by the abduction of her family. And if you've had the chance to read it, if you haven't, we have this in our ebook library, and I'd be happy to tell you how to get access to it. It was partly born from Anthony's own experience at St. Petersburg. I recently learned in an interview, which I wish maybe you would tell a little bit today. This novel received immediate and enormous praise and reviews in the New York Times, Washington Post, Chicago Tribune, NPR, and many others. It became a New York Times bestseller book and book review notable book of the year, a Washington Post top 10 book of the year, an ALA Notable Book of the Year, and many other distinctions. It earned the 2014 National Book Critics Circle's John Leonard Prize, the Annisville Wolf Book Award in Fiction, and the Carla Furstenberg Cohen Fiction Award. It's also a National Book Award long list selection. Anthony has written before about Chechen with a short story of that same name, which earned him the Pushcart Prize, Narrative Prize, and Winning Writers Award, as well as his recent story, The Grosny Tourist Bureau, which was published this year, which immediately won the National Magazine Award for Fiction. Russia continues to be the setting in his latest novel, collection of stories, The Tsar of Love and Techno, which is also available in our ebook library. This book also, not surprisingly, has already become an indie bestseller, and received rave reviews again as remarkable, audacious, and a stunning masterpiece by critics from the New York Times, Washington Post, and many others. So without further ado, it is a great honor, and we thank you for joining us today at the American Center. Mr. Anthony Marra.
Thank you so much for coming out on this blustery Saturday afternoon. I really appreciate it. If at any point my voice begins to drop in volume, please just give me a shout and am I okay back there? Okay, good. So I'm going to discuss a little bit about my work and about the role of the novel in contemporary society. 4 years ago, I visited the Grozny City Center, which is a complex of skyscrapers at the heart of the rebuilt capital in Chechnya. The buildings were 30-some stories tall. And when I arrived, I found a large group of office workers who had congregated on the street outside. The electricity had gone out, and they were waiting for the power to go back on so that they could take the elevators up to their offices on the upper stories. I began talking with one of them, a young man, and he told me that he had recently moved back after living in Moscow since the 90s. And he said that the house that he had grown up in was about a kilometer away, within walking distance. He asked if I wanted to see it. So I followed him to an empty field. There was a couple of fragments of concrete, but otherwise it was nothing more than knee-high grasses. And he began to rebuild the house that had been there with a story. He described the house where he had lived with his parents, with his brothers, with his grandparents. This house was destroyed in 1995. And on that empty field, it only existed in the story he was telling and in his memory. When he finished, he asked me to join him in the middle of the field so that his friend could take a photograph of the two of us. And I asked him why. And he said, so that I can remember that you were a guest in my home. I bring that up because photographs tell stories. And like any instrument of storytelling, they are susceptible to subjectivity and unreliability. They're susceptible to the designs of their authors and the vanities of their audience. So this afternoon, I'd like to talk a little bit about my work as a historical novelist through several images, and to ask this question of how the historical novel is relevant in today's world. We just had an election in America, as you probably are aware of. And there's this quote by Solzhenitsyn that has been that I've been thinking about quite a bit since last week. Can a man who is warm understand one who is freezing? Over the course of the campaign, you again and again saw Trump and Clinton supporters deny and delegitimize the hardships and fears of their opponents. And the question that many in America are asking these days is not whether one who is warm can understand one who is freezing, but whether one who is freezing can understand that anybody else might freeze, whether one who is freezing might admit that he doesn't have a monopoly on being cold. This presidential campaign was conducted in this post-factual environment. There oftentimes seemed that there wasn't a common set of facts or shared national narratives that both sides could agree upon. Ideology, it often seemed, had supplanted reality. The Oxford University Press this week released its Word of the Year. And the Word of the Year from the Oxford University Press, which publishes the Oxford English Dictionary, is post-truth, which they define as relating to or denoting circumstances in which objective facts are less influential in shaping public opinion than appeals to emotion and personal belief. This past week, President Obama was in Athens, Greece, and he spoke about the prevalence of fake news that has circulated throughout the course of this election campaign. There was a study conducted that was released on Wednesday, I believe, that discussed this prevalence of fake news on Facebook. More fake news stories have been shared, commented on, and liked than real news stories. More people on Facebook were reading these fictions than were reading actual legitimate news articles by places like the New York Times or Washington Post. And so in the literary world in America, this question of how do you write fiction in a world, in a political society where facts have become fictionalized, where our very understanding of what is true and what is false seems to perforate and degrade by the day. These problems are compounded by the fact that in American literary in the American literary culture, it's often been somewhat taboo to write about political issues. That there is this sense that fiction, that art should stay above the fray of politics. And this is something that I strongly disagree with. That if we are to be, if the novel is to remain a culturally vibrant art form, then it must engage in public life. Well, the two books I'll be discussing this afternoon are set in Chechnya and in the Soviet Union. I have in the past written about Northern Ireland in the 1980s, Italy in the 1930s, and Hollywood in the 1940s. My interests are less geographic or culturally specific than they are thematic. The uses and misuses of history, the moral dimension of citizenship. How and where do political decisions make landfall within those farthest from the source of political power yet closest to their consequences? How does the very act of storytelling, of building narratives, how can that be corrupted and co-opted into a means of falsification and coercion? I arrived to Russia at first through its literature. In college, I studied Russian literature in translation. like many readers before me, I fell in love with the great Golden Age writers, Tolstoy and Turgenev and Dostoevsky and Pushkin. I was living in Los Angeles at the time, and these authors posed questions that seemed every bit as relevant to life in 21st century Los Angeles as they did to 19th century St. Petersburg. How do we live with dignity in a world that rarely rewards it? How do you go about making decisions if your own moral compass runs contrary to social values? How do you live a good life? These are questions that I feel like in American literary circles we treat with a degree of skepticism, as if we are suspicious of the very sincerity with which they are asked. My college had an educational exchange program with St. Petersburg State University, and so I spent a semester in St. Petersburg. I arrived a couple of months after Anna Politkovskaya was assassinated, and I would see every day Russian veterans from the Chechen conflict panhandling in metro stations. This conflict seemed like something that was so alive and visceral in the environment at that time. But as an American, I had no real understanding of it. It was utterly foreign to me, as it was to many other Americans. And I began to research it and to learn about it, not as a writer, but rather simply to try to understand the place that I was living in at the time. Years later, this would become the setting for my first novel, a book called The Constellation of Vital Phenomena. The book is set in a hospital over the course of several days at the tail end of the Second Chechen War. The book is not about rebels or soldiers, but rather is about how political violence magnifies moral choice inside the lives of ordinary civilians. I believe that novels are humanistic enterprises, that the imagination is capacious. And I wanted to see if I could get American readers, people who by and large wouldn't be able to find the Northern Caucasus on a map, and see if I could get them to care about the characters and the lives of those living in this particular place. The book was about Chechnya, but it was also about post 9/11 America, the war on terror, and the war in Iraq. I don't put a great deal of stock in historical analogies, but it seemed like there was these reverberating echoes in the causes that led to and the consequences resulting from the Chechen conflict that really rang true in America. Things like the abuse of executive power, the willful misleading of the public, the results of indefinite detention, torture, Islamophobia, and how these various factors inflame the very violence that they seek to subdue. It's difficult, I think, to address these issues head on in American fiction, because so many of us tend to read stories through our own partisan lens. By exploring in this distant and removed setting the kinds of ethical questions that felt germane to American life at the end of the Bush years, the novel asked its audience to assess their own positions and biases. Several scenes in that book were inspired by photographs, and I became increasingly interested in how images shape the historical memory. We tend to ascribe objectivity to the camera, that this is giving us the documentary truth. But some of history's most memorable photographs have endured not in spite of, but because of the powerful scenes, the powerful fictions that they create. These are two images from the American Civil War. They're arguably the two most well-known images. They were taken by a photographer named Alexander Gardner. Alexander Gardner was a pupil of Matthew Brady, who was probably the single most important American photographer of the 19th century. These two images were taken at the Battle of Gettysburg. The one on the left is called Sharpshooter's Last Sleep. The one on the right is called Home of the Rebel Sharpshooter. These photographs were taken in the direct aftermath of this battle. It was one of the most decisive battles of the American Civil War, and they portray the carnage of Gettysburg with stark horror and tragedy. When we remember the Battle of Gettysburg, this is what we think of. And yet, these images are staged. The fallen soldier that you see on the left-hand side was moved about 40 yards up a rocky fortification and was positioned in that pose on the right. The rifle that you see in both photographs appears in most of Alexander's images of Battle of Gettysburg, and it was likely a prop that he had taken from his studio, and he would arrange it around the images, the figures of the fallen rebel soldiers that he was documenting. Though the soldier is labeled in these images as a sharpshooter, he was in fact an infantryman. Alexander Gardner understood himself to be an artist, and he believed that as an artist, he could reposition reality the way a painter would in terms of painting a canvas. He wanted to create a scene that would maximize the emotional impact of his audience. And over time, this stage scene becomes the way that we interpret and remember this event. This here is Abraham Lincoln. 4.5 months after Alexander Gardner took those photographs of Gettysburg, Abraham Lincoln went to Gettysburg and gave his famous Gettysburg Address. Lincoln in this image stands erect and suffused with nobility and purpose. This is the way that we as Americans want to remember Abraham Lincoln. He is the great emancipator in this. He's surrounded by symbols of patriotism and scholarship. The only problem is that isn't really Abraham Lincoln. It's actually an image of John C. Calhoun. Is anybody familiar with John C. Calhoun? John C. Calhoun was a senator from South Carolina. He was a major defender and proponent of slavery. After Abraham Lincoln was assassinated, there was a need for images that portrayed Lincoln as this heroic and fearless figure. And there weren't that many. And so they decided to make some. And so they made this portrait of Lincoln on the left, taking a photograph of Lincoln and stitching it on top of the body of John C. Calhoun. So you have this iconic portrait, this sort of famous image of Lincoln being the defender of liberty, being the great emancipator, when in fact it is the body of a defender of slavery. Now, if the expression on Lincoln's face on that photograph on the left, if it looks at all familiar, it's because that portrait was used for the $5 bill. So the image that you see on the $5 bill is that Lincoln. It's been flipped. So Lincoln in the $5 bill is looking the other way. It's been mirrored, but it is that face that we see on our $5 bills. Some of the 20th century's most iconic images were also staged or falsified to some degree. For decades, Joe Rosenthal, who took the famous photograph raising the flag on Iwo Jima, was dogged by accusations that he had staged this particular photograph. Decades later, it was definitively proven that he had it. However, the actual figures in that photograph were misidentified. And the most famous of them went his whole life claiming that he was one of these Marines. And it was proven earlier this year that he wasn't. If anybody has seen the Clint Eastwood directed film Flags of Our Father, that's based on a memoir of the son of one of these men who was in fact not one of these men. The image raising the flag on Iwo Jima in turn inspired one of World War II's other most iconic images, that being raising a flag over the Reichstag. Evgeny Kalday was inspired by Joe Rosenthal's photograph, and he wanted to create an image that similarly exalted the courage and the intrepidness of soldiers fighting against fascism. And so that became the subject of this photograph on the right. The red flag that you see there was in fact fashioned from tablecloths by the photographer's uncle. In the original image on the left-hand side, you might notice that the skies are a bit clearer. In the published version on the right-hand side, you may notice that this sort of apocalyptic skyscape has been added. In the dark room, they inserted this sort of these dense veins of smoke. In the original image on the left, you may also notice that that the soldier has watches on both of his wrists. The image on the right, he only has a watch on his left wrist. This was, again, the photographer. He airbrushed out the wristwatch on the soldier's right hand because his superiors were concerned that that the audience who saw this photograph would assume that the soldier had been a looter and had been stealing people's watches. And so they got the wristwatch out of there for the final published image. These images, you know, sort of become embedded in our historical imagination, in how we interpret the past. When we envision the American Civil War or Abraham Lincoln or the Battle of Berlin, these are the images that are evoked in our mind, even if they have been staged as carefully as a frame in a Hollywood film. But what about images that aren't falsified to heighten a patriotic emotional response? What about those whose purpose are to terrorize or to obliterate? While I was working on my first book, The Constellation of Vital Phenomena, I came across a collection of photos by David King called The Commissar Vanishes. David King was a album designer. He designed a number of Jimi Hendrix record covers. And he found his inspiration in Soviet art. And so he made a lot of trips to Moscow and St. Petersburg. And he became obsessed with falsified images under Stalin. These two in particular really spoke to me and haunted me. They're by Alexander Rodchenko, a constructivist artist who had published a compendium celebrating the Uzbek Communist Party called 10 Years of Uzbekistan. In the 1930s, many of these party leaders were purged, and Rodchenko was tasked with the sort of gruesome responsibility of defacing his own photographs. David King suggests that the violence of Rodchenko's self-censorship becomes its own kind of medium of artistic expression, that through his application of India ink, his portraits of people become portraits of phantoms. In other images, sensors were deployed to airbrush out the politically disgraced. Artists were employed to erase the faces of enemies and traitors, because to simply possess an image of a traitor was a traitorous act in and of itself. After finishing A Constellation of Vital Phenomena, I had intended to move on from Russia to other topics, but I kept on coming back to these images. I kept wondering what it would be like to live with the moral contradictions of a portrait artist who has trained to imprint the essence of an individual face onto the page, and who is instead forced to use his talents, his instruments, as means of erasure rather than creation. And that became the subject of my second book, The Tsar of Love and Techno, which is about a failed portrait artist who is put to work censoring photographs and how those photographs move over the course of the 20th century. So what is the point of any of this, really? We live in a literary culture where the books that rise to the best, to the tops of the bestseller list, the quickest are those that are written swiftly, read swiftly, and forgotten swiftly. What's the point of trying to write something or read something that is engaged with politics or histories that are removed from the little sphere that each of us inhabit? It's a good question. And it's a question that was posed to the Peruvian writer Mario Vargas Llosa about 15 years ago. And Mario Vargas Llosa had this to say. He said, "I think we must recognize that nowadays many writers, particularly writers from the new generations, have a very different idea of what literature is about. They think that literature shouldn't be too ambitious, particularly heading towards social aims, because this is not really something that literature can achieve. They have accepted that literature is entertainment, sometimes sophisticated and brilliant entertainment, but entertainment and nothing else. They're usually disdainful of writers who in the 40s and 50s and 60s thought they could change the world with novels and poems. But in this, I am anachronistic." Anachronistic, Vargas Llosa says. "I still think that novels and poems can change the world. Not in a very immediate or visible way, but I think good books of literature have an influence on a life, can change consciousnesses, personalities, attitudes, and I think readers educated and enriched by literature act on history to produce changes in the world." So that is all what Mario Vargas Llosa had to say on the matter. He's very grand, and I hope he's right. But this question of where this touches down inside any of our lives is one that that I thought about a lot, and I don't have as comprehensive an answer as Mario Vargas Llosa. But I do have one story that I think speaks to me personally as to how any of this matters, and that is a story of a Chechen surgeon and his two nephews. The surgeon was a man named Hassan Bayev. He was born and raised outside of Grozny. He attended medical school in Siberia. He didn't have enough money to pay for both tuition and and rent, so he slept in a train station for his first year. Later he was found out to be this terrific wrestler, and he was put on the wrestling team and got a dormitory. He graduated and he became a cosmetic surgeon. At the outbreak of the Chechen conflict, he was the only person in an area of about 80,000 civilians with any kind of surgical experience whatsoever. And his specialty was cosmetic surgery. And so he taught himself trauma surgery. He opened a field clinic in his basement. He was severely understocked and understaffed, and he would perform these complex surgical procedures with rudimentary instruments. He lived by the Hippocratic Oath. He would treat anyone regardless of military affiliation or ethnicity or religion. He saved hundreds, if not thousands, of lives. And because he would treat anyone regardless of which side of the conflict they were on, He ended up having bounties put out on him by both the Russian army and the Chechen insurgency. He had two nephews, Ali and Adam Tepsurkayev. Ali was a medical student, and he helped his uncle, Hassan Bayev, in the field hospital. Adam Tepsurkayev was a journalist. He was a videographer, and he worked for the Reuters News Service. In the late 90s and early 2000s, at a time where there were no Western journalists reporting from this region, Ali and Adam would smuggle video cassettes inside of cigarette cartons across the border and exposed this conflict to the wider world. And because of this, of course, Adam was was a wanted man. On August 23rd in the year 2000, soldiers ransacked the family home. They were looking for Adam, but they were unable to find him, so they took Ali instead. For 6 weeks, Ali was held in a hole. It was about 4 meters deep, it was 1 meter across, with water a few inches deep. He was shackled, he had no shirt or shoes. Every day he was interrogated and tortured. They wanted to know where Adam was. Every day Ali refused to say anything. He was offered his freedom if only he would give up his brother, Adam, but Ali refused. One of the soldiers was impressed by Ali's defiance, and they began talking. Ali down below in his hole and the soldier up top. They struck up something like a friendship. The soldier snuck Ali extra rations and helped secure the guns that were necessary for procuring the ransom that would release Ali. With the soldier's help, Adam was able to free Ali for a ransom of $10,000 and 10 guns. Now, Adam had been preparing to flee Chechnya when Ali was first detained, and so he had to postpone his escape in order to secure Ali's freedom. It took Adam until November 2000 to organize his passage to America again. He was going to leave via Azerbaijan on November 23rd, the year 2000. But 3 days beforehand, on November 20th, gunmen arrived at the home where Ali and Adam were hiding, and they shot them both. Adam died on the way to the hospital. Ali survived, and he fled to Moscow using a neighbor's passport. Some of what I told you I first learned about in a memoir by this surgeon, Hassan Bayev, called The Oath, about his time as a surgeon in this conflict. There are other bits of it I read in various testimony that Ali had given. And as much as anything, it was this story of Ali and Adam, two young men who weren't particularly political, who weren't particularly religious, and their struggles were what got me thinking about writing fiction set in this part of the world. 3 years ago, I did a reading on Nantucket. Nantucket is an island off the coast of Massachusetts. It's sort of a resort town, a sort of affluent beach community. It's about as geopolitically removed from the Northern Caucasus as you can get. After I did my reading, I was approached by a woman with a Russian accent. And she said that she had read my first book in her book club and said that in the acknowledgments, I had written something lovely about her uncle-in-law. I asked her who her uncle-in-law was. She said, "The doctor, Hassan Bayev." I asked who her husband was, and she said, "Ali Tepsurkayev." Ali had received political asylum in America through the help of several human rights organizations, and he had been living there with his wife and his young daughter. He came from a town where most freestanding structures had been destroyed, and on Nantucket, he built houses. He began as a laborer, then became a contractor, and is now on his way towards becoming a real estate developer. The last time I visited him was about 5 months ago, and he took me to this plot of land that he had just purchased, where he was going to build a spec house. He was going to build a house just to sell to someone else. And he began describing the house that he planned to build there. He described each of its rooms, the architecture, etc. And it was this eerie echo of this conversation I had with this young man in Grozny years earlier, except that for Ali, the house that he was describing lay in the future, and it had yet to be built. Now, as you might imagine, there are not too many Chechen refugees living in Nantucket. But his wife has said that A Constellation of Vital Phenomena has proved surprisingly popular with readers in that area, and that the willingness of his community to engage with literature set very far from home in a very distant place has allowed their neighbors and friends to better understand where this one young man has come from and how far he traveled to get there. So I think maybe I'll end there, but if there are any questions on anything really, I'd be delighted to take them. Yes.
But I'm sorry, did you use your imagination? I mean, from Chechnya to Nantucket, it's really a huge way to go.
Did I use my...
Your imagination? It's a real story, or this is all fiction, it's your imagination. Because I have been in Nantucket, I went to Boston University, I know Nantucket I really love.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's a long way from Chechnya to
it is,
Nantucket.
Yeah. I mean, the story I just told about Ali is
yeah,
is,
but it's
true.
A real story.
That's a real story,
oh,
yeah.
I see.
Yeah.
I thought it was just, you know.
No, the story about Ali is yeah.
Okay,
is,
I thought you real. Just imagined this. Yeah. You
no.
talk something and then, you know.
Yeah, no, that's
fuck.
Yeah, that the story about Ali is a true story.
Okay,
yeah.
There you go. Thank you.
Are the Chechen problems interesting for American readers?
Are the Chechen problems interesting for American readers? For some, yes. For most, no. But one of the things that I wanted to do with that book was looking at Chechnya. And posing questions that seemed very interesting to American readers. Questions about our foreign policy, about certain decisions that we were making in terms of invading Iraq, in terms of how we treated enemy combatants, that sort of thing. It became interesting to American readers following the Boston Marathon bombing. That occurred in April of 2013, and all of a sudden, for the first time really, there was this sudden interest in Chechnya and its history, because people wanted to understand the Tsarnaev brothers and what in their past might have contributed to their actions.
May I ask, do you agree with the Chechen conflict? Was not just a conflict against Chechnya, but just was a conflict against international terrorism.
Yes.
It's the first. And do you find the same futures if Chechnya conflict and a Syria conflict nowadays? Do you agree with this opinion?
Those are two excellent questions. I think that it depends when you are talking about the Chechen conflict. I think in the beginning, in the 90s, I think that it changes over the shape of the conflict from one that you know begins more as an independence movement, and then it becomes radicalized and becomes much more of a terrorist movement. So I think it's
international terrorism.
Well, yes. I think that the ways in which you see, particularly from 1998, 1999 onward, the influx of foreign fighters and that is, you know, quite troubling. In terms of Syria, I honestly don't know enough about Syria and that particular conflict to give a good answer.
And what do you think about Chechnya embracing Islam?
What do I think about Chechnya embracing Islam?
Yeah.
I think it depends what variety. I think that when I
because you are a Christian, you are not.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think that people should practice whatever religion they want to. But I think the question of how over the course of the last 20 years, a much sort of more conservative interpretation of Islam has flourished in Chechnya, I think is in large part due to this, due to the conflict and the influx and the sort of the importation of Wahhabism within that region.
And also, you were talking about when you were living in St. Petersburg, you would try to understand this conflict, yeah, what was going on with veterans. But I mean, you had the same war in America. You had a Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. You had Korean War.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, my dad is a Vietnam War.
And you
War
had
vet.
The same problems with American veterans when they come back from Vietnam and government just left them.
Yeah, I think that the fact that you see similarities in vastly different places is a reason to is something to explore and something to look at. You know, my dad fought in the Vietnam War, and at that point we certainly didn't treat veterans the way we do.
Exactly. Many of them became homeless, many got psychological problems, and they were just left by the government. They were just left on their own.
I think, yeah, in different circumstances, yeah, you see certainly that sort of thing.
Because I read a lot of Michael Moore's books too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's an interesting writer.
Yeah, absolutely is.
Can you tell us a little bit about your writing style? How do you construct a plot? How do you stick to the plot? Do you work with an editor or closely with an editor? How do you manage your timelines to getting the task finished? Maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. I tend to write many drafts. I believe in rewriting that. That I never use, you know, I never use a red pen to edit or anything. I always rewrite everything that I work on multiple times. And it's through rewriting, I think, that you begin to figure out the voice of a particular story or novel. In my experience, it's only been after rewriting something for, you know, 6 or 7 times that I begin to hear the voice of the narrator for the first time. In terms of constructing a story and sort of figuring out where you're going, I would say that that for me, every time I get stuck in a plot and I don't know what to do next, I always look back at what I've already written. And I see where I can use something for a second or a third or a fourth time. There's Chekhov's gun, his famous gun on the wall that, you know, needs to come off and be shot at some point. I strongly sort of believe in that as a dramatic principle, that everything you introduce into a story needs to have a purpose, needs to be there for a reason. And so when I'm writing and I'm struggling to figure out what to do next, I look back and see where the various Chekhov guns are within the story and how I might take them off the wall and put them to use. Because my work is so often based on research, I often turn towards the various turn towards the research itself as a source of both inspiration and direction. So one example might be I'm presently working on a book set in Hollywood in the 1940s, and I've been researching all of this material on these sort of low-budget film studios that made B-movies. And this is one little bit of research that I've recently discovered. And it's a story about how in one of these studios, they didn't have enough money for advertising. They couldn't advertise, they couldn't market. So they were trying to figure out ways of getting people to come to their movie. So what they did was they decided to hire a bunch, the movie was called The Night of the Stalker. And the studio decided to hire a bunch of guys to dress from head to toe in black, and then to wear black masks over their face, and to wander around cities with machetes, and to chase people down alleyways and into side streets. And when the people saw these masked men coming and screamed, they would take off their masks and say, "If you think I'm scary, go check out The Night of the Stalker, coming to a cinema near you." And it's such a silly little story. And I know I'm going to use it at some point in my book. And so now I'm thinking of how I can write the plot in order to include that at some point. And so if you have enough of those destinations in mind as you're writing, you begin to figure out how you're going to create a journey or a path that will let you get to these various places, these various stories, these various moments that you want to talk about.
Excuse me once more. Is your plot quite clear when you start? What do you find it evolves, and how do you kind of stop yourself from diverting into lots of little vignettes and side stories and interesting things like that?
Yeah, it's very difficult. I think for me, the plot is never formed. I'm never thinking more than a couple pages in advance. There might at times be sort of like you know vaguely where you're going. One writer described his writing style this way, and I thought that it was an accurate way of describing how you write a big novel. And he said that it's a writer named Edward P. Jones, and he said that he wrote by the way you might drive across the country. So say you're living in New York City and you want to drive to San Francisco. San Francisco is your destination, but you don't know which road you're going to take to get there. You don't know what you're going to see along the way. You don't know what side roads and what diversions and what dead ends you're going to take when you leave New York and you start heading to San Francisco. But you know at least what general direction you're going in. And that San Francisco sort of gives you that end point. You might not end up in San Francisco. You might end up in Seattle or Los Angeles. But that gives you a kind of velocity and a sense of direction. And so I think that for me it's similar, that I kind of have an end point in mind, but aside from that end point, I don't really know what's going to happen more than a couple pages ahead of time.
So it means you don't have a clear structure of the book when you start writing, say, particular parts of the book. Is it clear for you, or is this kind of developing you as a writer?
Yeah, I would say it's the latter, that it's developing as you're writing. I think that as a writer, if you're not surprised by what you write as you're writing it, then nobody's going to be surprised by what you write when they read it. And so I think that the best writing, the most interesting moments in a book are the ones that you didn't anticipate, the ones that you didn't plan for. I think that a book is often sort of takes a life, takes a sort of life and a movement of its own. And that as a writer, you're not necessarily creating it as much as you're sort of, uncovering it. You're trying to discover this thing that is hopefully somehow bigger than your best intentions. I would say that the process of writing is a process of trying to discover what your story actually is, what it is you're actually writing about. And for that reason, I don't really try to plan it out too much in advance.
So it's kind of creating something very predictable, and that's why it's not interesting in some simple stories. If they're predictable and people are don't interested, just read or watch these stories, like, see, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean,
if it is predictable, if the reader knows what will happen next, it's kind of maybe become boring.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would absolutely agree. I think that if you try to plot out a book in an afternoon, no matter who you are, it probably won't be all that exciting or surprising. That instead, if you're in the moment, if you're like really thinking about what a character is doing in each second, wouldn't have otherwise planned for begin to occur to you. And that's where I think things get surprising and unpredictable when you're in the midst of it rather than planning it in advance.
I think that the author should be neutral for the events described in the historical events.
Should
be objective and not show us your own opinion about the events that you are describing, historical events, and let us, let the readers form our own opinion and just provide us with the facts.
I think it's a good question, and I think there's no simple answer to it. You know, I think that if you're talking about a work of history or journalism, that objectivity is essential. But I think in fiction, by virtue of the form, there is a degree of subjectivity made within it. I think that what I don't like, or what I think is wrong, is when authors are clearly casting judgments upon their characters. If a narrator is saying, you know, this person is bad, you shouldn't like them. For me, what's most interesting, both to write and to read, is to really think about how bad people are made to be sympathetic. If we can, as readers, sympathize with people who act in ways that we disagree with, people that we wouldn't want as our friends, but nonetheless want to spend time with on a page. I think that's a really fascinating kind of dynamic between a book and its reader. And I think in those cases, you really don't want the writer to be prejudging anything in there for you. That you do want, if not objectivity, you want the characters to at least present themselves in the way that we all present ourselves. I'm guessing that none of us here think that we're bad guys, right? We don't think we're villains. Nobody thinks they're the villain of their own story, right? We're all heroes. And yet I'm sure that we are each the villains of someone else's story. And the fact that we each see ourselves as heroes and while other people see us as villains, I think is something that you can portray in fiction in a way that perhaps gets to some of that complexity.
So you do a lot of research work before writing. Are you a journalist or are you a writer?
I'm definitely not a journalist. I'm a fiction writer. I mean, I think that, you know, I do my best to present things as completely and comprehensively as I can, but I think that the purpose of a journalist is to inform and enlighten. And I think the purpose of a fiction writer, of a novelist, is to help people feel certain things. And for that, you know, it's I spend much more time thinking about how a character thinks, how a character feels, what their inner world is. I spend more time thinking about that than I do about the kinds of things that would obsess a journalist.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I'm a big fan of Sarah Lovington, and I really liked how you had all the different characters tell their own stories in their own perspective. And you kind of just touched upon how you think a lot about how the characters think and feel. I was curious as to whether or not you are basing these characters on people that you've met along your research and your travels, or if they are purely of your imagination.
Yeah, a great question. For the most part, they're of my imagination. Certain ones are influenced by various people that I've met along the way to some degree or another. One of the the title character is in that book, the Tsar of not the title character, the narrator of the title story, is loosely inspired by a childhood friend of mine who lives in Ukraine, and was sort of obsessed with really cheesy techno music and all of that. In my first book, there were more moments where certain things were inspired by or influenced by real figures. But for the most part, it's they're composites at best, or totally fictitious.
Did you read the books about Chechnya by Anna Politkovska? If you do, do the influence on your interest for Chechnya?
Yeah, the question was on Anna Politkovskaya. Yes, she was probably the single most important journalist and writer that I turned to when I was researching that book. It was the information that she gathered was certainly part of it. I mean, just the sheer scope of her reporting. But it was also the ways in which, you know, she could, on the one hand, describe the way that money and power is routed through these complex bureaucracies, but she would also, could capture these heartbreaking and intimate moments. She's a journalist, but for me at least, she was a true artist. I remember in one of her books, she has this conversation that she overhears between these refugees who are on the side of the road. And they're discussing how not to get shot. And it becomes this sort of Samuel Beckett-like absurdist conversation where these two gentlemen understand how far from the land of reason their lives have veered, and they are able to sort of discuss that. And I would also lastly say that just beyond, the information and these sort of incredible human moments that she captures, what really has affected me about her work is the moral clarity with which she writes. I think that most of us writers, our conscience is sort of like a little candle, and she just seemed like she was a roaring furnace. And the fact that her work speaks with such conviction and such a longing for and a demanding of justice for everyone was something that really affected me and my work.
I'm sorry, I can't really hear what you're saying.
Do you feel that now mass media make another light on Chechen conflict in the past, at least before in Russian to invasion? Another question, do you have any appeal, future appeal,
Yeah, so regarding the second question of writing about sort of the refugee crisis, I tend to look towards the past to try to understand the present. So the book that I'm working on now is in some ways about 2016. It's about 2016, but it's set in 1940, and it's about the wave of European refugees who were fleeing fascism and who end up in California. It's about the rise of populism in America at the time, which clearly echoes our contemporary politics. So I think that there are all different ways of writing about issues that are issues that pertain to, you know, current events that aren't necessarily about current events. So one example would be that one of the comments in America that I often get about my first book, Constellation, is that it made people think about the Syrian refugee crisis differently. The book was written before Syria. I hadn't had that on my mind at all. But people saw echoes in terms of a humanitarian crisis And so I think that, that good books can perhaps speak to various time periods and various geographies and can hopefully move across those borders of topicality, so that, you know, something that is about the Chechen conflict can maybe give people a new way of thinking about Syria, how a book about, you know, California in the 1940s might help people think about 2016 in a different way. I think that for me, the best books are the ones that are able to do that, the ones that feel timeless in a way. I would say that Anna Politkovskaya, as somebody who wrote so specifically about such a sort of specific issue, I think her works, you know, we still read them in America today. 15, 20 years after they were first published, not necessarily because people want to know more about that particular moment, but because it helps them better understand the world right now.
Did you have a chance to communicate with Chechen citizens? Are they open to a book?
The ones who have read it are now living in the West, are living in America. So those who have read it have responded to it positively. I'm not sure, it's not translated into Russian yet, and it's not available in Chechnya. I know a couple, I've emailed with a couple of teenagers and people in their 20s who have downloaded it online illegally, and they've been written to and so that's been translated to the university. But it hasn't been, as far as, to the best of my knowledge, it isn't widely read there.
Izuchal Ruski Zik, the Petersburg, Yazabil Fsio.
So two last questions. One is, how do you keep to the plot? You set yourself a kind of time deadline to get something completed that you don't run the risk just kind of sliding all over your technical lines. And the second question, are there any writers that you aspire to, that you kind of, that sort of inspire you and you try and emulate their styles?
Yeah, I think in terms of like sticking to deadlines, what I do is, I am a big believer in, I teach at Stanford and I live in the San Francisco Bay Area. And everybody there is obsessed with data and about tracking everything and giving everything a number. And I've kind of bought into it a little bit because I keep a daily word count now. I figure out how many words I write each day and I keep track of them. And if I write more than 1,000 words, I mark it down in black ink. And if it's under 1,000, I mark it down in red ink. It sort of becomes a way of conditioning myself to try to get that 1,000-word mark every day. I think in terms of like how you figure out where you're going, I think that it's really tough to do that in if you're setting yourself a deadline like that. I think that some books take, you know, people years to do. Other books take months. I think it's entirely dependent on the particular project. Regarding authors that I admire, one person in particular might be a British writer named David Mitchell. He wrote a book called Cloud Atlas. That was his most famous one. They made it into a movie with Tom Hanks. He's somebody who is able to inhabit any voice. He can. He's often called a ventriloquist, because he's able to speak from the perspective of really anyone. And his ability to sort of mask himself within other characters is something that I think is incredibly challenging. And it's something that I would aspire to do, I suppose.
May I ask you about a former United States ambassador in Moscow, Mike Markford? He's a Stanford University professor, basically. Mm-hmm. He's doing very well. As far as I know,
he's doing well.
For me, he's very right because he's the best of ambassador for forever in this country. Yeah? What do you know about him?
I've met him once, I think he's a very smart and wise interpreter of contemporary events. I know he's had a bit of some issues maybe in recent weeks, but I think he's one of our smartest thinkers on foreign policy.
I am going to present your book at the nonfiction fair in Moscow in December.
No, I'm not. It's not nonfiction. It's fiction. So.
What do I think about the
perspective of your work, your writings?
Sort of my perspective or the perspective on your work. I write for an American audience, basically, folks who don't have a great deal of familiarity, and so it's largely reviewed and covered by Russian immigrants to America, folks who left when they were kids, and from that perspective, I think it's been fairly positively received in terms of its reception here in Russia. It hasn't been translated into Russian, so it's limited to people who can read it in the unfortunate way.
Two questions. First, do you see any major similarities and differences when compared to Northern Ireland conflict in the 80s? And second one, why the authorities were so determined to get his brother, like he was on his way out anyway?
Yeah, you mean in the Ollie and Adam?
Yep.
Yeah, well, in that circumstance, it was because he was documenting war crimes and sort of exposing some very ugly stuff to the wider world, and I think that there was a sense that he had to be punished for that. In terms of the similarities with Northern Ireland, I mean, I think that that every place is different, and there's only so much you can gain from sort of historical analogies. But simply the idea of a disputed territory, the sovereignty of Northern Ireland has long been disputed. Does it belong to the Irish? Does it belong to the English? I think that you see a similar sense of disputed sovereignty in the Northern Caucasus. I think that this question of sort of an asymmetrical combat, you have the entire English army going into Northern Ireland, not the entire army, but a major world power, and on the other side you had a couple hundred of IRA guerrillas fighting, and I think that in Chechnya there's a similar kind of asymmetry to the battlefield. In Northern Ireland there was four cases of human rights abuses that arose from the conflict there on both sides. And so I think there are certain similarities, but I think that there are probably more differences.
You chose four Russian women to the characters of your book, the names Sonia and Natasha. Is it influenced by Tolstoy, War and Peace?
A little bit, yeah. Nobody's picked that up back home. But nobody reads War and Peace there. Yeah, sort of a nod to, you know, my real sort of items of my own. All right, well, is
there's no questions, thank you very much for